Well, my first experience with music was, I guess I was 7 years old. Well, let's see, I was 9 years old or 10 years old. And my father was living in the projects in the Bronx, Melrose Projects. And my father would come home from work and he would immediately say, dance contest. And he would put on a 1957 recording of Duke Ellington live at Newport. And we would, my brother and I would dance to that particular track, a particular track called the Diminuendo and Crescendo in Blue, particularly Paul Gonzalez's multiple rousing chorus solo. Mm-hmm. And we would do this, you know, at least three times a week. And then shortly after that, my father came home and with a paper bag, and he gave me a trumpet. And he said, this is for you, and he gave my brother a saxophone. Mm-hmm. And we took, my brother studied up in Harlem with a saxophone player named Fats Green, who resembled Cannonball Adderley. And I took lessons at the New York School of Music, which was on 149th Street and Willis Avenue. And then it became a really part of our lives, because when we were kids, we got, for Christmas, we got these Fanner 50, these guns that you play, yeah, cowboys and Indians with. But our favorite game as kids, we played jam session. So we'd take the gun and turn it around and pretend like it was a trumpet. Mm-hmm. And perhaps we even did this before we got instruments, mm-hmm, I think. And our favorite game was jam session. Yeah. So we were really into the music, but it was just really like part of our lives. We didn't know, you know, anything about being famous or being a musician, and we didn't really want to be musicians. Later on, I found out it was my father's dream to have us playing the Ellington Orchestra. Right. My Duke Ellington was one of my father's idols. He had a few. He had Geronimo and Sitting Bull, okay, Joe Louis,
yeah,
and
the Brown Bummer,
and Duke Ellington, and he had a scrapbook full of musicians he had cut out, and that was around the house.
Right.
Then I moved from trumpet to trombone, and later on when I was in junior high school, I moved to cello, and then eventually from cello to string bass. And I was, people say, well, I listened to, just began to become attracted to the bass. I listened to any record, it was a bass, every record we bought, you know. Saturday was record buying day. And you could, in Hearn's department store in the Bronx, they were switching over from Monaro Records to Stereo Records. So all the Monaro Records were selling for 99 cents. So you could, you know, he'd give us $5 and we'd go down and we'd get him some Ellington. Mm-hmm. And then we would get us something. And at the time, they had all the Atlantic Ornette Coleman records that were available. And so we didn't know what the music sounded like, but we were intrigued by the covers, very interesting covers. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because they didn't really have any covers with the women on the car, yeah, on his records anyway. Mm-hmm. And so the covers were very intriguing. So we bought Ornette Coleman. And one thing led to another. So you read about Ornette Coleman, and you see in the liner notes they're talking about John Coltrane, yeah, and Cecil Taylor and other players. And so eventually I thought I could make a contribution to music by playing the bass. Yeah. And so I got my first bass. It cost $100. at Bronin's Music in the Bronx. And when I got out the store, I was walking down the street with the bass, and a guy came to me and said, "Oh, are you a bass player?" And I said, "Yes, I suppose." And he said, "Well, you know, come to this jam session up in Harlem. You know, this was like on Monday, and come up there on Sunday." And I had previously I met this was in the early 70s, and I met the bass player Charlie Hayden. He was playing with Carl Berger at the public library, and they were doing these concerts. So I went up to him and introduced myself, and he said, "Well, you know, when you get a," I told him I was thinking about getting a bass. He said, "When you get a bass, you play along with records." He said that's how he learned, and you know, and then things would just come together. So I practiced with records all week till Sunday, and I went to the jam session, and I got there, and the guy said, "Oh, the bass player's here, bass player's here." I said, so I looked around, I said, "Who are they talking about?" He said, "Oh, it's me." Yeah. And so I played and said, "Well, we're going to play this tune. Is F okay?" And I didn't know an F from a G, from a B flat, from a C. But I played, and they gave me some solos, and I was able to hear the music. And I played till my fingers were big red bubbles. Wow. I had no chops. And so I said, "Wow, I got to, how am I going to get out of this?" So I said, "Oh, what time is it?" And he said, "Oh, it's you know, it's 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, whatever time it was." I said, "I gotta go. I got another session to go to." So I left that session, and then I said, "Well, I have to really get chops and learn what I was doing." So eventually, I went to the Jazzmobile, 131st Street and Park Avenue. IS-201 was a school, and on Saturday they had the jazz school. And Richard Davis was one of the teachers down there, and Milt Hinton, and Art Davis, and Paul West was the director. Lee Morgan was there, Kenny Durham was there, Curtis Fuller was there, Benny Powell was there, Sir Roland Hanna was there, Jimmy Heath, Frank Foster, Bud Johnson was down there. And so I came in, and Paul West took me, there was no classroom, so he put me in the bathroom, empty bathroom, and he said, "Okay," me the chart for Fats Waller's tune, Honeysuckle Rose, and show me the half position. And so I was practicing and working on that. Then I got a knock on the door, and it was the janitor. And he said, "What are you doing in there?" I said, "Well, I'm practicing." He says, "It's 5 o'clock. The school ended at 4 o'clock. He said, "If I hadn't heard you in there, you would have been stuck in this school for the rest of the weekend." So I was really intensely practicing, but my heart had already been given to the fire music. My heart had been given to Archie Shepp and that kind of, and Cecil Taylor and Albert Eiler, and I wanted to play that music. But when I would come up to Joe Newman and say, "Well, you know, what about Archie Shepp?" And they said, "No, we don't do that here." But I knew that something said, "Well, you know, you have to become one with your bass." So I played all kinds of stuff. I was playing with you know, practice and played, and then things just began to happen. I worked with a ventriloquist, a guy with a dummy. I worked with folk singers. I worked with dancers. I worked in a play. I worked with anybody that wanted a bass player. I would play with them, and so I eventually left the Jazzmobile and went and began to study with Jimmy Garrison. At his house in Western Avenue. And I met Elvin Jones and Beaver Harris and many, many musicians. This was like 72, 73. And I eventually met Billy Higgins. And in fact, I met Billy Higgins and Andrew Hill on the same day. It was a musician, tenor saxophone player by the name of Juice, who had a place on 11th Street between B and C. It was a firehouse. And I was down there playing a duo with his 8-year-old son. And then Billy Higgins came in and took the drumsticks from him, and he began to play. And then I was playing duos with Billy, and then he was living out in Brooklyn, St. Mark's Street. And so he invited me out to his house. The cello player, Munir, I think, lived next door to him. And we began to play duets, you know, 2-3 times a week, sometimes 4 times when he was in town. And I met Clifford Jordan down there. I met Chris Anderson, the piano player. And I met Wilbur Weir down there. And eventually I began to study with Wilbur and play with Rashid Ali and Sonny Murray, going over to Studio Ribby. Schedule was really vigorous and heavy at that time, because I would walk from the base with my walk from the Bronx with my bass on my back, come downtown and start at the firehouse and just play, rehearse with the Juice Quartet, which is a wonderful group, late piano player Kassa Allah and Phil King and Abu Kali were the drummers, among others. And I'd play there till about 1 o'clock. Then I'd go over to Studio We, where they had the Wee Music House, 193 Eldridge Street, and James Du Bois ran that program with Juma Sultan and Dave Burrell, Carl Berger, you know, Daniel Carter. I met down there. Well, I met Daniel Carter previously, but he was down there. Gunter Hoppe. There were many, many musicians, so you play there until as long as you want. Then around 7 o'clock, Studio Ribby, Sam Rivers' place, would open, and you'd go down there, and
that's a loft, wasn't it?
Yeah, 24 Bond Street was a loft downstairs, and Sam lived there with his family. So, and each Monday they'd have one group play the whole Monday, every Monday in December, and another group on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. So at a time I was playing there three times a week. I was playing there with Charles Brackeen. Mm-hmm. With Jamil Moondock Ensemble Muntu, which was another training ground, with Arthur Williams and Rashid Sanan. I played there with a group called Flight to Sanity, which was Harold Smith and Art Bennett at the time. He changed his name to Idris now. Played with Charles Tyler, Steve Reed, many, many musicians. And then after Studio Ribby, and about 11, I'd go over to the 6th Avenue, and we had a basement downstairs, and I'd play with Dewey Johnson, with Daniel Carter, with Billy Bang, with whatever musicians would come by there. And that was Roger Beard, Malik Baraka. You know, whether you know these musicians or not, some of them have passed, some of them are still with us.
I know many of them.
Yeah. And so we played there till 2 or 3 in the morning, and then sometimes I would, afterwards, we would talk about music. Mm. So music was 24/7. Yeah. Eventually, I'd make it up to the Bronx and then come back down the next day, because everybody was on it.
Yeah.
You know, everybody was on it. Around 1978, Dennis Charles came back on the scene. And 1978, 1980, and I met him at the Ocean Club, was playing with Rafael Malik, doing a double bill with Jimmy Lyon, Steve McCall. Musicians were coming in from California, from St. Louis, from Chicago. So it was a lot happening as far as musical activity. Mm-hmm. And the rents were low.
Yep.
And so that was...
You could do something at that time.
You could do something, you know. I mean, people didn't make too much money.
No.
In fact, but the music was developing.
Yeah.
And in 1975, I met Don Cherry, And I played with him at the Five Spot for a week, because I knew Frank Lowe, who we recorded a few years earlier in
77. Was that with Billy Bang? Because Frank Lowe worked with Billy Bang, didn't
he? Yeah, yeah, yeah. And but we recorded with Joseph Jarman and Rashid Sanan, and Raymond Lee Chang played the violin on that record on ESP called Black Beings.
Right.
And they just released another record that they found in the can with Steve Reed and Joe Bowie and myself and Frank Lowe. So there's
Joe Bowie,
trombone player.
Yeah, yeah.
So in 1974, I played at Carnegie Hall with Cecil Taylor.
Yeah.
So things kept crossing paths with different people, and that's how you really learn how to play music, is by playing. You can read about it, you can know a theory that, well, this sound is supposed to go with that sound, but you find that all the rules that you might learn are candidates for rules to be broken.
Yeah.
Because there really are no definitive rules. If you listen to what Duke Ellington did, he said, well, you're not supposed to arrange for these two instruments.
Yeah, and he did.
Then you can arrange for them. You can basically, anything can work in music depending on who does it, who can bring it to life, who has a vision about it. Who can.